Hello, everybody. Welcome to the new educator informational webinar for Future City. Thank you very much for joining us today. Glad to have you with us. Before we get started, if I could just get a raise hand from a couple of the attendees, if you can just click on the raise hand button to make sure you can hear me clearly and see the screen that says Future City HQ New Educator Webinar. Great. Thank you, Amanda and Brendan. Thank you very much. Well, my name is Jake Williams, and I'm the program coordinator at Future City headquarters. Also on the line is Maggie Dressel. She's the Future City program manager. And she will be answering your questions as you type them in. So feel free as we go to type any questions into the question box. A few housekeeping items before we get into the program. The platform we're using is GoToWebinar. And the recording of this will be available in the resources section of the futurecity.org website by the end of the week. So if you have any things that come up during this webinar that you'd like to go back and review, look at again, you are welcome to review that recording at any time. We'll also send it out by email to everyone who signed up. Also, if you're having any issues with the sound, with the audio, using it through your computer, you can also dial in to this phone number and use the code here, and you'll get an audio pin that will appear when you sign in. Sometimes the sound calling in over the phone is better than the computer audio. As I mentioned, if you have any questions at any time, feel free to type them into the question space in the control panel. Maggie will be answering any that are related to Future City specific things that, as staff, we can answer. And if you have any questions for our panelists, then we will collect them all and ask as many of those as we can at the end of the webinar in the Q&A section. So before we introduce our panel, I just wanted to provide a little bit of background on the structure of Future City. The Future City competition has been around for almost 3 decades, and each year we serve about 40,000 students. So that's about 40,000 participants each year involved in the program. Just in the U.S., we have 40 different regions and sub-regions that each run their own Future City competitions. We also have 3 official international programs, one in Canada, one in China, and one in the Middle East that's based out of Egypt. Maggie and I are with the Future City headquarters. We produce materials like the handbook, and we support the local regions who put on the regional competitions. And then we also host the finals competition here in Washington, D.C. each February. So regional programs are run by mostly volunteers who work really tirelessly to put on really great, amazing events. So when you talk to or if you see any regional coordinators or anyone who's volunteering at your local region, be sure to thank them for the great work that they do. So before we continue, it's great to remember that there are quite a few ways to do Future City. There's no one single right way. And there are 2 possibilities that you can consider, especially if you're a new educator to the program. You can use Future City solely as an educational resource, as an educational tool. That's what it's primarily for. But there's also a component of it that is a competition. So you should not feel obligated to compete, especially if it's your first year. It's a really great opportunity. It's wonderful for the students to be able to present their work that they've done and all their things that they've studied and created and to hear from other teams and see their work as well. But the competition is not a requirement. You can certainly use the materials of Future City in whatever educational ways that you would like without formally competing. And there are a lot of moving parts to Future City. The more that you read about it and hear about it, you might begin to feel a little overwhelmed. That's perfectly normal and perfectly fine. The purpose of this webinar is to demystify the process when it comes to talking about teaching and teaching specifically the Future City program. There really isn't anyone who's better than an experienced educator. So I'd like now to introduce our 2-person panel. Julia Johnson is an educator from New York who coordinates the Excel program for the Islip School District. She's also the CEO of Investing Self Inc. and the founder of the Gifted Education Network. She was the recipient of the International Society for Technology in Education, the Making It Happen Award, the Open Space Stewardship Program's Outstanding Teacher Award, and she's also been published in the newsletter for the National Association of Gifted Children Creativity Network. Julia, thank you very much for joining us today.
Well, thank you for having me. It's quite an honor.
And I don't think Travis is on the line yet, but he hopefully will be joining us soon. Travis Koppel is from is an eighth grade science and STEAM lead educator and specialist at Justice Page Middle School in Minnesota. Justice Page is a Minneapolis public school, and Travis has been participating in Future City for about 9 years. He used the Future City program as the foundation for reviving his school's STEAM program, and now it's received very high praise from the city council of Minneapolis. And on top of that, the program's success has caught the attention of the mayor himself, who has visited them a number of times. So before we get started, it's best to note that there isn't one single right path when it comes to Future City. Before you get started, be sure to give some thought to what your goals are with the program. And again, there isn't a single right or wrong answer. It's really helpful to just kind of consider these things before you start or as you begin to start. So think about things like what are you wanting to promote with your students? Independent learning, developing teamwork or delegation skills? Do you want to expand their understanding of the specific topic material for that year? And then also think about the audience. Are you wanting to provide a few kids very specific, tailored opportunities, or try to engage as many students as possible? So Future City, because it's so flexible, it can really be adjusted to a vast, wide variety of situations. Classroom, after-school programs can be used by homeschoolers, out-of-school time organizations. So Julia, the first question for you is, how do you run your Future City program? Is it a class or club or something else? And how often, how regularly, did your group meet last year?
Sure. So I run the program as sort of a hybrid. I coordinate the Gifted and Talented program in Islip schools. So there is time set aside for me to meet within the school day, but it's not a lot. It's only once a week for a couple of hours. And between teachers having tests and important events that kind of pull them from the program, even that is inconsistent. So the majority of the work that we do is after school. I make available evenings and weekends. It changes year to year. So when you ask, I'm glad you asked, how much time did you spend this year? I really leave it as a student-driven work initiative. So if I have a team that's super gung-ho, the rule that I set for them is I will work as hard as you will. So if I have a team that's willing to give it their all, they want to hang out on Friday nights and be here until the custodians are kicking us out, and then come back in on Saturday morning with donuts, then I'll do that. If the students are not as driven, it's important that they see that they're going to set the work ethic for what it's going to look like.
Yeah, that's a great point. We've heard from a lot of educators, a lot of first-time educators will ask, specifically how many hours is required. And just like you said, it really depends on how the students are using the time that they are working. So the next question I had was, how many students did you have on your team last year? And do you have an ideal number of students that you'd like to work with in a in an individual team?
Sure. So I've done different things throughout the years. And one of the things I love about Future City is it gives us an opportunity to have students learn from trial and error. So within the engineering design process, we learn more from our failures than we do from our successes. I also try to model that. So I have learned a lot through the failures of teaching Future City in ways that worked well and ways that didn't. So this year I had a team of four students. There were three presenters and one alternate, and we had four students from day one. I have also taught Future City with a larger group where we open it up to a full class and then figure out as the course of time goes who our three presenters will be. I've also tried it where we had a large group from the beginning but had preset our presenters from the beginning based upon a rubric that we agreed upon to be fair. There are benefits and drawbacks to all of those models. It's not that there's one best way to run the program. My personal preference is to have a small group of students that all agree they want to work hard, but I also don't close the doors to kids who would like to get involved.
Excellent, great. So typically most educators usually start Future City in late August or early September when the school year begins, and then the regional competitions take place in January. So it's working from fall to January. What time of the year, Julia, do you generally start organizing your team and begin to work on your Future City project?
So again, that depends upon the year. I've done it where, you know, I had very little interest from kids in getting the ball rolling before the beginning of the school year. Because we've been fortunate enough to do well at competition, that sort of creates more of a hype where students are able to say, hey, I really want to do well, what does it take? Instead of me telling them what it takes, it ends up being the students who have just gone through the program saying, you've got to get started now. So what I did was I put together an optional summer packet of fun for activities that they can do to introduce them to some of the concepts throughout Future City. So even simple things, it's, you know, important to make it interactive and enjoyable. So I had them, one of them was like, go to the beach and make a city out of sand and think about, you know, create a story about who your city is for and just kind of introduce. Then I do get into introducing them to some of the concepts. So giving them some topics that they might consider looking into, to get some of that common language out of the way so that when students come in ready to do work, if you start talking about engineering and kids don't know what engineering is, you know, that's a different stepping stone that you need to cover, as opposed to coming in with a foundation that's already been established and you start saying, well, what do you think about zoning? And they know what that word is. Or what are you thinking about how we should go about the SimCity? And they've already had a chance to play it over the summer because they knew it was a requirement and they wanted to get familiar with the game. So it changes based upon, again, the kids' work ethic and what they're willing to do. Early start time is the best way to go. If you have a way of knowing who your kids are going to be the year before and you can give them some summer stuff, some summer home fun to do, it's definitely going to make everybody's job a little easier.
Excellent. Great advice. The backbone of the Future City resources really is the program handbook. And that is released each year in mid-July for that upcoming season. So we don't yet have the 2019-2020 handbook, but if you go to futurecity.org and then the resources section at the top of the page, and then click on the handbook and student handouts section, you can download for free last year's program handbook, and you can review it. The specific topics and details are going to be a little bit different. There'll be a different challenge for this upcoming year, but the overall structure is very similar. So you can go ahead and get an idea of what the handbook will be like, what you can expect for this upcoming year. And we really recommend that you read it cover to cover. It has a ton of information. It kind of outlines the whole program and has a lot of resources. So Julia, how do you approach the program handbook each year?
Exactly what you said, Jake. Reading every single page is imperative. And also knowing it, I tell my kids, this is your Bible. So I do share it with my students. And I tell them this is what every single team is looking at. They have the same resources as you have. So if we don't use those resources to their, you know, fullest potential, then we're really kind of from the get-go not giving ourselves the opportunity to do as well as we possibly could. So I give them the opportunity to mark it up, to make their own copies and to come in with questions and with ideas and I come to them saying, how do you think we should use this as a resource? What were your takeaways after looking the whole thing through?
Great, excellent. So you mentioned the deliverables. What are the deliverables? There are five of them that your team will produce throughout the Future City season. And these deliverables are judged and scored by the judges, and they're the each of the sections of Future City that your team will be working on. So we'll go into each of these more in depth, but just a quick overview of the five deliverables. The first is the project plan, then the virtual city. This is the deliverable that involves the software SimCity. Then there's the city essay and the model, which is one of the most visually recognizable parts of the program. And the last deliverable is the presentation, which is done by the three official presenting students of the team. So going back to the handbook, the first half of the handbook features an overview of the program, as well as information on the engineering design process and project management, and how these things fit together with the larger work that you'll be doing with your students. Then the second half of the handbook are these appendices, and that really, these in the appendix, it really dives into the specific details of each of the five deliverables. So you can see here, this is from page 40 of the handbook. You can see how it's very clearly laid out to match up with each of the deliverables. So you start with the project plan, you have the requirements, the resources, then the template for the project plan. The virtual city has the requirements, the resources. There's a page that is a handout for the students, and then the rubric. And all of these are the same. They each have the requirements, the resources, handouts, and then the rubric. And the rubric here is the same rubric that's used by the judges. So you can see yourself, and you can share with your team the specific details that the judges will be looking for with each of the deliverables. So to start out, the first deliverable is the project plan. It's a great tool for the team to organize and manage their work. Students record their project goals. They plan how they'll complete the deliverables and monitor the project's progress overall. So a well-crafted project plan will help students stay on track, kind of like a roadmap that they can refer to as they move through the competition. But it's also adjustable. It's also changeable. Decisions made at the beginning of the project may turn out to need some revising along the way. And so these templates are available, like I said, in the handbook and also in the resources section of the website. So Travis, are you there?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Yep. Thanks. Thank you for joining us. Unlike the other deliverables, there's no rubric for the project plan. So, but it's also still a great resource. So Travis, how do you describe the project plan to your students?
I describe the project plan to the students as essentially, here's what needs to be done, who's doing it, and when it's going to be done by. It is a schedule of events that allows them, as you mentioned, to keep on track. I see, for my particular setup, I see them every other day. So in order for them to compete at a competition level, they have to do a lot of meeting outside of class, and the project plan allows them to do that without me standing over their shoulder telling them, where is this, why isn't this done? They can look at their own project plan and see, okay, here's what needs to be done, here's who's working on it, and then if something's not done, they know who to go to.
Excellent, great. Julia, there are a lot of different ways educators can choose to have their teams complete the project plan. How do you like to have your team work on it?
So I really lean towards a student-driven approach. All the questions that you're asking me, I start by asking my students that same exact question. So I hand them the project plan and say, what do you think of this resource? How do you guys want to tackle it? So instead of handing them the tools for organizing their time or coming up with a strategy, I find that even though it takes more time, it's worth it to invest in having them go through the struggle of figuring out on their own the best way to handle it. And they really feel a great amount of ownership over it once it's their own ideas for how to best use these tools.
Great, excellent. So the second deliverable is the virtual city. And SimCity is a great resource to help students think about and to better understand all the complexities of city design and management. When they use this, they'll see how decisions like where they place roads and power plants and how different zones work, zoning works, how all those things affect their city's growth and development. This deliverable, students choose two goals that they want to achieve in their virtual city. in their SimCity, and at two different points during its development, they'll document their progress toward meeting those goals. So some examples of goals that they might choose could be something like having a population that's highly educated, having a city that's free of pollution, could be having public transportation that's available for all residents. And they compile this information in a template, a PowerPoint template. And not to be confused with the presentation, this is separate from the presentation. This isn't a PowerPoint that they'll present. It's a PowerPoint that will be uploaded online that then will be reviewed by judges. But they put it in this template of a PowerPoint that shows their progress on these goals that they decide. So Julia, how do you structure your team's work on the virtual city? Do all the students work on it together, or do just a few work on it? How do you usually do that with your teams?
So when we begin planning at the beginning of the year, we look at all of the deliverables and come up with a calendar and mini goals that we're going to set for ourselves. And most of it is them coming up with their own plans of how they're going to go about it. The only requirement that I have is that everyone must work equally on all parts of the competition. And that's, there are teachers, like you said in the beginning, Jake, there are different ways of teaching Future City, and it's not that one way is the best way. You really need to, as a new educator in this competition, come up with, try on different hats and see what resonates with you and what works for you. I like this method the most because it takes kids outside of their comfort zone. So a kid who says, you know what, I'm really good at playing video games, I want to only staying on working on the virtual city. Let other kids who are stronger writers get involved with the essay. Let other kids who are better builders get involved with the model. When we stay within our areas of strength, we don't experience growth. So by having all students participate in all aspects of the competition, first of all, the workload is fairly distributed. And second of all, kids end up coming outside of their comfort zone to develop new skills. Did that answer your question? Sorry.
Absolutely. Yeah, great answer. Travis, how do you decide which of your students do what? Which work on the virtual city and make those decisions?
Yeah, so I'll leave it to the team to decide. When I structure teams, I generally try to make them as self-sufficient as possible, where I let them kind of decide who wants to take on what roles, let them kind of choose which path they feel most comfortable with. However, as Julia was saying, I do require that every team member do an equal amount of work. So that means if a student says that SimCity is not really my thing, then I will expect to see progress on the essay. If a student says that I'm really good at SimCity and not very good at writing, it's like, well, then I expect you to be sitting there problem solving through the SimCity portion of the game. So I let students kind of play to their own strengths. And then as a team, they're going to have to, eventually they're going to have to put all those pieces together into the essay, the presentation, and the model. So with the, I often do the SimCity and the model concurrently. So both going on at the same time. And then I have tried setting where if it's a team of four, then two students have to work on the essay, two students have to work on the SimCity, and then they switch roles the next time I meet them on the every other day schedule. And I found that this hasn't really worked. It's actually created more conflict in the team, where the students who are really good at the game get really mad at the ones who aren't, saying that you messed up everything we did, and vice versa with the essay of, we had all these really good paragraphs and all these really good ideas and you just messed it all up. So I actually created more arguments trying to tell them what it is they needed to be working on. I've had greater success and smoother team dynamics by letting them choose and then working out the conflicts among themselves.
Great, excellent advice. Julia, if you have any technical issues with SimCity, these do arise from time to time, how do you usually address them? Do you work with your school's IT department? Do you get in touch with Future City coordinators? What's your strategy usually for that?
It's a great point to bring up. Being proactive is really the best way to go about it, and expecting the fact that unless you're homeschooling, you're going to have issues with, I even saw, Travis had to work through a firewall to get onto the webinar today. So there's always some kind of obstacle that we might not be aware of until the moment hits. And in those moments, it's usually like a week before the deadline that the deliverable is coming up and students are in a panic and it's after school hours, so there's no tech person to ask. In order to avoid coming to those situations, you're better off sitting down with your IT department, before Future City, even before you purchase the program, and saying, here's what we're looking to be doing, you know, going to be doing, what is the best way for us to go about establishing a foundation to run this program without any issues? Based upon how your school district works, they might have different suggestions, but bringing them in from the beginning will definitely help you to avoid as many obstacles as possible.
Excellent. And last question on the virtual city for Travis. What type of involvement or supervision do you and or your team's mentor have with the virtual city deliverable?
I can tell you my mentor is pretty old school when it comes to technology. So he's very good at offering suggestions as far as here's what your city needs, less so much on the gameplay. For myself, I definitely monitor their progress. The progress checks are great. I generally will just move around to each team and ask them specifically, what is your goal and where are you with your goal, and have them really lay out that this is what we said we wanted to accomplish, and here's where we're at as far as accomplishing it. And again, the project plan comes in handy with this, and is helpful with this as well. This was your team who spent a week trying to solve a train station problem when trains had nothing to do with their goal. And it was, you're spending all of your time in the wrong place. And so I try to definitely monitor, make sure that they are on track with their goals. Also, there's a few, as you get more familiar with SimCity, you find out, for instance, this year I had students for their, you can add wind turbines or wind power to your city. And instead of upgrading the existing structure, they just kept adding more wind farms. So they had at one point 20 single turbine wind farms across their city, not knowing that, well, why don't you take one wind farm and add 20 turbines instead of having 20 singles? So just making sure that, and then that just comes with becoming familiar with the game. So you really, my recommendation is to get SimCity and become familiar with it yourself before you get students involved. Or if you have students who are really good at it, have them teach you along the way, because you will come across students who will find themselves in these problems. And it's really helpful to kind of put yourself in their situation of, oh, I had the same problem that you did. Here's how I solved it. If you come up with a better way, please show me. So it kind of becomes more of an interactive experience where this is what I did. If you find something better, or if my way doesn't work for you, show me what you did. But definitely keeping an eye on their goals, because the game can get overwhelming to somebody who is a first timer with it. So just making sure that, again, they don't get overwhelmed, and they all know the answers that they're supposed to put, that my city should be 100% wind power and I should have no pollution. And then they watch their budget just explode and they can't afford it anymore. So it's also helpful with the SimCity is also a good tip as far as what is realistically possible. Sometimes their best ideas are brilliant ideas, but SimCity doesn't allow them to go through.
And for when you're just a little bit of background on the way that SimCity works, if you're new to Future City, the codes we offer when you register, one or two codes, and each code can be downloaded onto up to 5 computers. And those are released also in mid-July, same time as the handbook. So if you need, if you'd like to start working on the software before then, you're welcome to purchase it. It's available commercially through Origin and through on Amazon. It's the most recent version, simply called SimCity, not SimCity 3000 or SimCity 4. There's also a number of resources available, again, in the resources section. If you search filter by SimCity, there's information on how to take a screenshot, advice for working with your IT department, general play instructions for the software. A lot of resources there that are great for you and for your team. The next deliverable is the city essay. The essay is the place where students get to kind of delve deeply into the details and ideas of their future city. Though it's based on facts and is really a well-researched piece of work, it also can be very creative. It's the team's opportunity to describe what it's like to kind of walk down the street of their city. It's also where they can share some of their most amazing ideas. The city cannot be more than 1,500 words, and it may have up to four graphics. It also needs to have a minimum of 3 citations, although a lot of high scoring essays have many more citations than that. The essay is really where the team starts to address the annual topic or challenge each year. And if you register in May, before the end of May, you'll get a preview of the topic for this year. That preview will go out in early June. So Julia, how does your team approach or divide up the work for the essay?
So again, everyone needs to be involved. We begin by brainstorming together. There's a lot of coming together, coming up with a brainstorm, and then divide and conquer for the execution. So everybody has to have the same vision. And once you have a game plan, if you have an outline, then it makes it a little bit easier to delegate the work, especially if you have a large team. So for example, if you have a section that a student is going to take on, you know, I'll be the person responsible for relaying about our communication. And another student says, I'll be the person who translates everything about our transportation. Another person says, I'm going to do the introduction paragraph. Another person says, I'm going to be the editor who looks at our language to make sure the whole thing comes together seamlessly. That being said, just like every other portion of Future City, how well you do has to do with the amount of time and effort that's put in. This past year, my students did about 30 revisions of our essay. The last time that I taught the competition before this past year, my students did about 74 revisions of their essay, and we won Best Essay. They were not inherently amazing writers. I didn't write it for them. They did 74 revisions of an essay. So I think it's all about, you know, taking the time to painstakingly keep going back to the rubric. We start with the end in mind. So before we even look at the requirements of the essay, we look at the rubric and how we're going to be scored. And that kind of guarantees that you're going to do just about as well as you think you're going to do.
Right. That's a lot of revisions.
Yeah, it was.
Travis, where do you first direct your students usually for doing research? Do you have a specific location or a few specific locations usually kind of direct them to when they're first starting out?
Absolutely. The handbook is the first place I tell them to go. The handbook, looking at the rubric, and there's also a list of suggested questions that they should answer. So if they look at me blankly of, I have no idea what I'm supposed to be looking up, then I can provide those documents and say, this is what you should be looking up. This is where to find what it is you're looking for. And then we also do some work with evaluating sources of what is a good source of information versus what is not. And we'll do some work around that as well. But no, the handbook and the pages within the handbook about the essay are where I start every year. And then after we do that, we do some evaluating sources, and then they see what they come up with.
Excellent. Julia, what's the most difficult part of the essay, both for you and or for your students who are working on it?
That's a great question. I would say making sure that it maintains authenticity for a 7th and 8th grade level while setting the bar as high as possible. I would say as an educator, that's definitely the greatest challenge that I have. When you look at some of the award-winning essays that are available on the website, they are incredibly well-written, and they're dealing with really heavy content for a 7th and 8th grade level. So I won't do work for my students. It needs to come for them. So there's a lot of connecting the dots of background knowledge, of grammar and punctuation, of research skills, like Travis was pointing to. And all of that needs to be laid as a foundation in order to get them to the level of writing that's going to meet the expectation and the standard that's been set, which is incredibly high. So making sure that it's their work and that they're not writing something they don't understand. So that's really been a problem when we work through the revisions. They'll have something that sounds amazing and I'll read it back to them and say, explain to me what that means. And they can't do it, because they're reading heavy content articles that are a little bit above their level. And that kind of goes against the grain of why we're teaching this competition in the first place. So striving to find the balance between authenticity and a high, rigorous demand of content.
Excellent. Travis, how does the essay relate to the virtual city for your teams? Do they incorporate lessons learned from SimCity into their writing, or are they completely separate for you?
No, they are most definitely interlinked. The essay is the backbone of everything. That's why I always have them start the essay congruent with the SimCity. So as they're working on it together, they can start sharing ideas back and forth. So that way the essay feeds into the SimCity and the SimCity feeds into the essay. And they're both, as they're working together as a team, doing both at the same time, they can get ideas from both deliverables and apply it to the other. So no, the essay is absolutely the heart of the whole thing, and the SimCity feeds into that, and just as the essay feeds back into the city.
Great. Julia mentioned reading past teams' essays, and that's a really great thing to do. If you go to the gallery section next to the resources section of the Future City website, you can review the top five finalists' teams' essays from previous years. So that's a really great resource for you and for your team members. The fourth deliverable is a scale model of a section of the team's future city made out of recycled and reused material. And the entire cost of the model cannot be more than $100. This levels the playing field for teams, and it encourages creativity and innovative ideas and use of materials. A couple components of the model that are good to keep in mind is that there should be parts that reflect that year's challenge, that theme. It also has to include at least one moving part, and be sure that your team's model is within the size requirement. So not larger than 25 inches wide by 50 inches long by 20 inches high. So for Julia, when does your team start working on the model usually?
So if you consider the collection of materials, then we start over the summer or as soon as I have my students. So even while we're working on the preliminary deliverables, they have a model in mind. So we talk about any time that you're, you know, at Starbucks and you see a cool looking drink container, or you are looking to help your parents with cleaning out the basement and you see something that might be interesting, we just put aside a bin, and my classroom looks like I have some kind of a hoarding issue because there's multiple bins just full of what would be trash. The actual layout of the city, we start with creating blueprints. And again, that depends upon the structure of scheduling that's been defined by the students. So the students come up with their own workflow planner. And based upon when they outline, my job is to just kind of show them the planner. You said, you know, listen, guys, just so you know, we're coming up against Thanksgiving. According to your schedule, you would like to be in the middle of planning out your model right now. Are you where you want to be? So it changes every year based upon the work ethic and the flow of the group.
Travis, from where does your team usually get your model materials from?
As Julia was mentioning, anywhere we possibly can. I'm fortunate enough here at my home school, we have a makerspace in the building that I also oversee. I oversee our STEAM program, and we have people bring us donations of just anything you can think of. We got old electronics for motors. We pull fans and wiring harnesses and things out of these old electronics. We have plenty of other materials lying around, outdated science kits that I find stuck in closets, plastic bottles, yogurt cups, packing materials, old foam pieces. We have a few of our families who work in like a building trades, and they'll bring us old leftover construction material. So we get pieces of conduit piping and lumber, all kinds of just random stuff. So really, where do we get materials from? Any possible where we can find them. The students will bring in whatever they can find. And because we do this program as a day school program, so many of our students are familiar with it before they sign up for it. So they will come in, or their parents will come in with collections of stuff that they've been saving because they knew they planned on being in the course at some point. So they will, I found this really cool thing, I've waited a year to use it, here it is. We want to put it in our model. So,
excellent. Julia, Travis mentioned that they have a makerspace. Where do you work on your model? What are some pros and cons for various location options for actually the location for constructing the model?
So we also work within the classroom. I would say the pro is that, you know, everything is contained here. So there's no issue of, oh, I went to do that, but it's at home. The con is that it's so time sensitive, this portion of the competition. This is usually when it's crunch time and the, you know, time is so difficult to find in the classroom. So the biggest issue we have, honestly, is getting kicked out of the classroom by custodians. It seems like there's been a great amount of effort that's gone into Travis setting a culture and a climate. There's this expectation of what's happening and this knowledge from other people. And that's really imperative. So similar to that, I have students who don't participate in Future City, but they understand what's happening. So they know like not to touch anything. And I actually have had the custodians coming to me saying like, we weren't gonna throw this out, but we know you're teaching Future City and we didn't know if it was actually garbage. Because what might look to be garbage can easily get, become like, you know, but that's part of our nuclear power plant and you just, you know, threw it in the trash. So yeah, time is definitely the biggest obstacle, but I would highly recommend doing it inside of the classroom unless you have students that you know are going to find the time to work outside of the classroom, and then you're really kind of risking not knowing what they're doing.
Travis, what's your team's process for keeping on track with the budget of only $100 for both the model and also any props used for the presentation? How do you keep your students within budget for that?
Yeah, so every material that we use, I have them either add to the project plan, or we do everything through Google Doc, so they can all collaborate because they have every other day schedule. So they'll add it to the Google document. Any materials that we have, anything that they purchase, they save the receipts and we scan those in and add those to the document as well. Then all the recycled materials, we'll just take a look at, you know, what sort of a value do we want to assign to it? I got caught, I shouldn't say I got caught. I realized the hard way that you have to assign value to even the recycled materials. So I assign values to everything, even if it's really small. Even random scraps of cardboard I'll pull out of the garbage can, I'll still assign them a nickel, just because, again, I had an issue where we actually lost we lost 5 points and it cost us to win at a regional competition because of that. So I'm really intense with the teams about keep track of absolutely everything that you are using and give absolutely everything a value.
Good thing to remember. And in the handbook, there is a section toward the end that outlines all the specific requirements, and it gives kind of an example too. So for new educators, that's a really great thing to check out in the handbook to make sure that you're calculating the budget for the model completely and within the rules. Julia, last question on the model. Scale is such an important component of the model. How do you teach this concept to your students and make sure that they follow through with it as they're working on the model?
So I try to give them real life questions to start laying a foundation of understanding. So over the course of a week, take measurements of things in your own home. How big do you think your kitchen is? And then actually measure the kitchen and see if you were correct. Because I noticed that for kids at this age, it's difficult to even have a concept of general size. And then we kind of work backwards from what's the tallest building that you want to show in your city? How tall is that building in real life? And how tall do you want to make that in your model? And then we'll set up a ratio from there and work backwards. We've also done it where we work based upon thinking about the whole city. So draw out the whole city on a piece of paper. How big would this section of your city be in real life? And then how big do you want this to demonstrate in your actual model?
Great, excellent. Also, just to remember, make sure that as both Travis and Julia mentioned, start collecting recyclable material as soon as possible. It's a great thing to do year round to have a good selection of things to choose from when you start working on it. Also remember that making a model that's sturdy and durable is very important, not only for transporting it to the regional competition if you plan to do that, but also making something that can be shipped if your team wins first place and you get to attend the finals in Washington, D.C. You'll want to make sure that your model is sturdy enough to hold up to that shipping, that transport. And the final deliverable now is a 7-minute presentation that three students give to a panel of judges on the competition day. They'll discuss features of their future city and their solution to that year's theme. The rehearsed presentation is followed by a question and answer session, and you can check with your regional coordinator for specifics in your area. So Travis, what roles do non-presenting students have in this process for your teams? The ones who are not actually giving the presentation, what do they do to help out with the presentation deliverable?
Yep, so they have a couple different roles. One of the roles is to be the audience for the rehearsals. I had a student this year who was not a presenter, but as they were rehearsing, he kept yawning and saying, "You guys are really boring me. You have to make this more interesting." So he was really just trying to encourage them. It's like, nope, not good enough. Go better. And it's like essentially he's saying, if you can hold my attention, then you're doing okay. So he would push them that way. We also used students for the special awards, which is another part of the regional competition. Those students who are not presenters will also kind of put together a little mini or do some research and do rough outlines of kind of mini presentations around the special awards, so that way the presenters can see those, look at them and say, okay, this, I understand kind of where you're going with this. I would like a little more information here, or I can fill in with that. So our non-presenters, again, are huge help with the rehearsal side of things, becoming an audience and a sounding board of, hey, we talked about that in the essay. Why is that not in the presentation? Because they know every part of the project better than I do at that point. Once you get to the presentation side, they know better than I do. So they're the ones saying that, hey, this, you're supposed to mention the engineering design process and you didn't. Where is it? Put it in there. And again, also very useful for any additional research that needs to be done. And we also do the model and the presentation at the same time. So oftentimes they are working on, while the presenters are rehearsing and finishing up, our non-presenters are hard at work getting the circuits wired and the lumber attached and all that other good stuff.
Mm-hmm. Great. Julia, what resources do you utilize to help your team train to present well? Do you have them practice in front of specific audiences, or what other strategies do you use to help them get comfortable for the presentation?
There's so many. If you're uncomfortable with teaching public speaking skills, the best piece of advice that I can give you is look up a local theater in your area and ask if somebody from that school wants to come in and do a workshop with your kids about projection and about using your body when you're public speaking. Usually actors and actresses are very eager to share, just as engineers are eager to share. And this is a totally different skill set that will serve kids really well in life. Just one thing that I can pull out of the hat that I would say is extremely valuable is to videotape your kids doing a presentation and have them watch it and critique themselves. You can tell them that they're not loud enough, that they're too fast, that they're moving their arms too much, whatever the feedback might be that they're hearing from you or from their colleagues. But for them to see it themselves is really, really valuable and is probably the greatest teacher.
Great, excellent advice. And just as with the essays, you can watch, you can see past years' presentations in the gallery section of the website. This is really great to kind of show your students what really high-scoring presentations look like. It's really great resource, so don't forget about that in the gallery section. So now moving on to the team mentor. The mentor is an official member of the team. You as the educator, sort of the day-to-day facilitator leading the team, but the mentor is a STEM professional, probably isn't there every day, but is kind of a role model and acts as a window into the world of STEM for the students. Many mentors get involved because they know either the educator or the students. So if you don't have a mentor already, you can think about if there are any parents of students, any relatives or family friends who are engineers, architects, city planners, or working in a similar field. Travis, how did your mentor get connected with your team?
Our mentor got connected with our team through our regional coordinator. My first year as Future City, I had a young college student as my engineer mentor, and he kind of disappeared on us to work on his studies. So the second year, I had mentioned to our regional coordinator that, hey, my mentor bailed on me. I need a new one. So I was very fortunate. She put me in contact with an engineer mentor who was a former regional judge. And he's a civil engineer. So he is, that's how we were connected. And he's been an absolute lifesaver. Our engineer mentor is very much our voice of reason. When the students have a great idea or have an idea and I think, wow, that's the best idea, let's go with it. We'll run it by our mentor, John, and he'll say, speaking as an engineer, that's impossible. So let's either see how we can make it possible or take your idea and see where else we can go with it.
And Julia, how did your team get connected with your mentor?
So I'm a little bit unique in this regard. I don't have a mentor. My kids just have me. For better or for worse. So what we do have is I usually go out of my way to try to get public speakers or connections for them to reach out to help us prepare based upon what the theme is. And that's proved to be very helpful. So for example, one year the theme was dealt with waste management. And we started with, do you know how trash is handled where you live? And we got a tour of our waste to energy facility here on Long Island, where our school district is located. And we toured a landfill and we learned about our water treatment plants. And we spoke with the people who work in our local town dealing with waste management. So if you don't have a mentor for starters, or if you're looking to enhance the mentoring or the knowledge of engineering even beyond just the mentor that you're provided with, reaching out to the professionals in your local community or not even local. This year we ended up Skyping in because the topic this year dealt with crises dealing with natural disasters. So we Skyped in engineers that work with crisis management teams in the Middle East, and they were from the other side of the country. So engineers are really very generous with their time and always want to help out. So even if you don't just have one, that doesn't mean that you can't help connect your kids to learning from a professional that you can touch base with locally.
Absolutely. Yeah. Don't be afraid to ask professionals to either come in for even just a day or for to Skype in. The worst they can say is no. As Travis mentioned, if you're looking to check in with your regional coordinator to try to be paired with a mentor, you can do that by going to futurecity.org, select the Find My Region button at the top, and you can get the contact information for your region. And the coordinator will do their best to pair you with a volunteer who's interested in helping out in your area. As we've mentioned several times, the resources button is kind of your best friend as you're starting out and continuing through the Future City process. When you go into the resources section, you can filter each of the materials by different options. So for example, here is competition forms and project plans. If you have questions about that, you can see the templates, you can see some advice and best practices. Julia, besides the handbook, are there specific Future City resources that you would recommend specifically for a new educator?
Yes. As a matter of fact, one of the best things that I set up earlier on was I had a lot of the resources that your students are going to find and your kids will find better resources than, or at least can find as better resources than you can even, because they're so tech savvy, they're so aware. Have it pooled in a location where it can serve your new team coming in. So for me, I created a student wiki. So when students find really great videos that introduce a concept of biomimicry or whatever the concept is that you will apply every year, that kids, you want them to have that as a background, as background knowledge. Instead of reinventing the wheel every year, you might initially have to put in a lot of work to pull resources together, but try to keep it in a library of sorts so that you don't need to reinvent the wheel each year to come up with a toolbox of resources. And your students can be enhancing that professional environment as well. I'll even have past year students posting things to a wiki for students who are coming in future years because they thought it would be a good resource for Future City when they found it.
Right. Beyond those future city specific resources, there are a ton of non-future city resources that are great to utilize as you're working on future city, things like universities that are near you, community colleges, city or local officials, city councils, local planners or managers. You can check in with construction companies or engineering or architecture societies. There are a ton of resources like this that if you ask people, they are more than happy to get involved. So Travis, are there any non-future city specific resources or experiences that you've utilized for your team in the past?
Yes, we started as you were mentioning, reaching out to engineers. Our school we have an enrollment of near 900 sixth, seventh, and eighth graders. So I'm fortunate enough to have a large pool of resources to pull from. And I essentially put just invites out to our greater community via our school newsletters and some of our school social media, asking anybody who is involved in city planning, city engineering, land surveying, computer aided design, software, programming, all these various areas. I started a weekly speaker series for my students. So every Monday we would have a speaker from our community who would come in and speak to a different area of the project. So we had software engineers from Cargill. We had engineers from the Minnesota Department of Transportation. We had a city planner, a public works director from one of our suburbs. And these are all just folks I simply said, who wants to come in? And they showed up. I did a brilliant job, and it was a great resource for our students who could, especially the surveyors, they could constantly refer back to, remember what they said in the presentation, or she had that really cool picture in that presentation. We also looked for, I was also looking for people who did not identify as male and people of color. So trying to get some more representation with our students, so our students could see that engineers are not just white males, but they come from all kinds of spectrums. And I think it was really useful for our students, and they frequently reference what they learned from those particular visitors.
Excellent, great. Well, we now have a little bit of time to discuss any questions. So if you have any questions for Julia, for Travis, or for the Future City staff, please type them in the question box now. Maggie, do we have any questions so far?
We have one question from Deborah, and she was wondering what language Travis uses to reach out to the parents, and if he'd be willing to share that. And if so, we can certainly distribute that.
Oh, sure. So I assume that, Deborah, I assume that you're asking as far as how do I word my ask. I can definitely share that with Maggie and Jake and have that kind of distributed out. But it really just has been, once again, our Future City for me, and I apologize for my tardiness. I was going to mention this in my introduction, but Future City for me has been the engine that has driven the resurrection of our STEAM program here at the site. Our school started as a standalone STEAM program that kind of caved in on itself, and our successes at Future City got enough people's attention that we have been able to sustain and grow the program every year for the last 3 years, which has been really great. And with that kind of that backbone in mind, it really simply has been, I teach Future City as part of a year-long engineering elective called Engineering the Future. So I will quite simply say in our newsletters or our social media that our Engineering the Future students are looking for anyone with background in engineering, city planning, land surveying, computer-aided design, whatever other areas you're looking for. We would love to have you come speak to us. I set up, then I just had them contact me for more information. I set up a Google form with a calendar. We had people choose dates for the calendar, and that's how we were. And then they'd make a first, second, third choice. I would reach out to them via email and say, this is the day and time that you mentioned, and this is the day and time that will work for us. So it really was just coming straight out and asking, are Engineering the Future students or Future City or whatever you might be calling the class, are looking for engineers, city planners, surveyors to come in and speak to the students. And I had more responses than I could fill. I had enough responses to go up through March, and I had to cut it off in December because we had to get ready for regionals.
Excellent.
Terrific. And I'll just add to that, if you do reach out to parents and struggle getting responses, maybe you're not as lucky as Travis, then the regional coordinator in your area can also help connect you to local engineering societies and just kind of use the context they have to get professionals and experts in your classroom or after school program.
Reaching out to local government officials is really nice too. Contacting mayors, city councilmen, representatives like that. Like I said, I'm in Minneapolis, so but we did manage to get one of our councilmen, and we also managed to get the mayor to come last year. So they like the PR side of it. They get to get into schools and discuss the workings of their city with the young people, and then the young people get to have that information about, wow, I just got to meet the mayor and he told me that this is how the city works, and they're able to use that to their advantage.
And then maybe the mayor will incorporate some of the future city ideas into their own work. You never know.
Well, he said he was going to, but I have yet to see it.
So if anyone else has any other questions, please submit them now. Now is the time to register if you haven't already. You can use this link here or go to futurecity.org and select the register button at the top. If you are a brand new educator, if you have not participated in Future City before, when you sign up, you can use the promo code FutureCity100. So it's all one word, FutureCity100, and your registration fee will be waived. That's only available through the end of May. So be sure to sign up before May 31st for that free registration. Any other questions, Maggie?
We have a question from Undine Wells, who is starting a Future City Club this year, but might only be able to do one afternoon a week. And she was wondering if that's enough time to complete all the deliverables. Travis or Julia, do you want to speak to that? And I'm happy to jump in as well.
Sure. I would say, listen, you know, I think to circle back to what Jake said in the beginning, that there are different ways of teaching Future City, and it doesn't need to be run as a competition. I can attest to the fact that the life skills that Future City teaches are going to come across regardless of whether or not you run it as a competition. And dare I say, there are even some benefits to teaching it as a curriculum itself without the competition component. So when you take the stress off, especially if it's your first year, especially if you have limited time and limited resources, it becomes so much more fun and more relaxed, and a great way to kind of jump into the swimming pool without feeling like you're going to drown. So you can still go to competition day and reach out to your regional coordinator saying, listen, we want to come and see what it's all about and showcase what we've done, but we're not going to actively compete. We just want a chance to see what other kids are doing. And that will help establish the foundation for a team that might be interested in competing or putting in more time on their own independently the following year.
Excellent. Great. Very good advice. Well, if there's not any other questions at the moment, I want to thank you all very much for joining us. And thank you, a big thank you to Julia and Travis for your time, for sharing your great advice. We really, really appreciate it. And thank you all of you who attended. If you're new to Future City and you have any other questions that you think of or comments or anything, please reach out to us. I can be reached at info@futurecity.org, so feel free to email at any time. And best of luck with your cities this year. We can't wait to see what the teams come up with. Thank you so much, and have a great day.
Yes, wonderful. Nice to meet you, Travis.
Nice to meet you as well.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.